Hey everyone, and welcome to this brief video where today I am joined by Mr. Frederick Johnson. Frederick, hey, how are you doing?
Hey, I'm doing great, Paul. How are you?
Good, thanks. And just to outline what we're doing here today, I wanted to highlight Frederick and his story because Frederick purchased my How to Become a Virtual Consulting program a few months ago. And we were connecting recently. He had a bonus call with me and I was just super impressed with the progress that you'd made. And you have this great story where you'd, I think you were pricing your proposals currently around the $4,000 to $5,000 level. And then you'd actually, since going through the program, you'd actually landed a proposal at about $14,000. And the story was just like, so it was just great to hear for me. And I just wanted to get you on a video and get you to share that with people. So no, thanks for joining me today. Maybe before we get into that, do you want to give people a bit of an introduction? Because you're probably slightly different to the normal customer who signs up to my program, the consulting. You're actually, you were applying it more to your sponsorship. So maybe give people a brief introduction on who you are and what you do.
Absolutely. Yeah. And first of all, before I do that, I want to thank you for putting that program together because this is not just, you know, Paul told me to say this stuff. It's really sort of changed the way that I think about how I'm approaching business, which I'll get into in a second. But what I do is I run a podcast called This Week in Photo. It's at thisweekinphoto.com. It is one of the longest running photography related podcasts on the internet right now. We're knocking on the door of 10 years. So we've been doing this since the beginning of podcasting, obviously. And the way that your stuff, Paul, worked into what I'm doing is, like you said, sponsorships and advertising on the show. So if you listen to a podcast before, you've heard the podcaster say, this episode is brought to you by fill in the blank. And then maybe midway through the show, they'll do sort of an ad lib, bulleted list read or whatever. So that on my show, and prices for advertising on podcasts varies widely depending on the audience and, you know, frankly, the salesmanship of the podcaster themselves. What I needed to do was I was sort of looking at what I'm doing, and what you teach resonated with me because I am not a fan of applying old world methodology to new media podcasting. Right. So in other words, right now, most podcasters are basing their work on CPMs or cost per thousand. So, you know, I get this many downloads, therefore I can charge this much money. I never really agreed with that because in podcasting, it's more of a tacit endorsement of the product from, you know, the host of the show. And, you know, there's so many other pieces to it. So even before I started, you know, sort of following the teachings of Paul Miners, my mindset was I want to be more of a Tiffany's, you know, versus the jewelry counter in Walmart or Target or something. I want to be able to, because you don't go into Tiffany's and say, wow, you know, this diamond, I could buy this at Walmart for $100 and you're saying it's $10,000. Can you justify that $10,000? I want to be more on the Tiffany side where it's more brand based and it's more, okay, I feel like my services to the client and my brand awareness and my endorsement are worth X dollars. If you want to pay that, then great. If you don't, then on to the next one. So that's kind of where my mind was heading. And then I discovered you.
And if I could pause there, because please finish the story, but I guess I'm hearing that and I'm thinking normal freelancers, coaches, consultants online, they typically would charge by the hour, which I think in your world is the equivalent of charging a CPM or cost per thousand. And with the consulting program and what you were doing as well, it's actually forget this old way of pricing. It's about getting paid what you're worth and focusing on the brand, like you said. So I just wanted to make that connection because I think typically when people start with consulting or freelancing, you go, okay, what's my hourly rate? But as you're going to tell us and show us, there's a better way to do it.
And I think it is a better way to do it. I think it's a better way to sort of think about your products and services. So that's where that light bulb went off and I saw, value-based pricing. Of course, that's the way it should be. So to make a long story short, what I did was, there's a pipeline of client, or actually I'm using Pipedrive, thanks to you. So there's a number of clients in the queue. And one of them, or then, you know, if we're rewinding back a couple of weeks, one of them I was pitching and I knew, you know what, this was kind of a take it or leave it client. You know, this would be great if I got them, but if not, I'm not going to lose any sleep. Yeah. You know, so literally Netflixing with my girlfriend on the computer, and had Paul sort of sitting on my shoulder, right? So I'm like, okay, well, normally for this service, I would bill out, you know, and we have a variety of services that we advertise on This Week in Photo. So normally it would be around $4,000. And, you know, that I came up with that number based on, you know, wouldn't it be great to just have $4,000 for 60 seconds of work and, you know, all this stuff. And but I wasn't factoring in the brand equity and the endorsement, like I mentioned, and all that stuff. And then with you on my shoulder, I'm thinking, you know what? I really think this is worth much more than that. And I know this client has a budget that can support that, right? So what I did was I went into the proposal and I justified everything. I had line items and, you know, so I made sure that it was, I could back up what I was putting in the proposal. And you saw, you've seen the proposal. So it was very, you know, very well put together. So I put that together and I sent it off to them with a very nicely written email looking, you know, I hope we can work together, yada, 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 you know. Then I set up the call, you know, to sort of walk them through the proposal. And on that call, I was expecting the objections, like, you know what, we can't really afford this. And, you know, how can you justify your price? And I can go to this podcast over here and they're only going to charge me X dollars. But it wasn't that at all. The response I got was, okay, but if we add this, can we, you know, it was more, can we pay you more money? You know, we add this on? Can we do this? And I was sort of shocked. I was blown away because I literally, I had notes next to the computer. It was a Zoom call. I had notes next to the computer. Then I was like, okay, if they say this, then I'm going to say, no, this is how I justify that. And, you know, I was completely ready to get off the call with no money at all. And I got off the call with a signed, you know, IO, insertion order. So that was an epiphany moment for me. And I've since gone through, since I sent you that email and let you know that went down, I've had three other clients similar to that, not at the $14,000 rate, but much higher than I normally would have billed them because I'm thinking value-based pricing versus this hourly and I'm competing with Joe Podcast next door. I'm more competing on my own merits and what I think I'm worth and what I think my endorsement is worth. So and it worked.
That's incredible. It's such a good story. And I think the lesson applies obviously not just to podcasting. It's just about knowing your value and the brand, focusing on your brand. You said you've been running this podcast nearly 10 years. Yeah. That's credibility that not like average Joe podcaster has no way of competing with. And so being able to just say, right, this is what I'm worth. Yeah, maybe the numbers, you know, you could get a better CPM or you could get more reach with a different podcast or whatever, but actually the message is better quality coming from me. And I think that concept of just knowing your worth and pricing based on value applies universally. It's such a good story. Any other like key takeaways from the program then, like standout, like light bulb moments that come to mind?
Yeah, well, just the whole flow. Like I said, that was the best money I've ever spent on your program. Based on that, I've signed up for Pipe Drive, which, by the way, my free trial ended yesterday, so I'm now an official Pipe Drive user.
Cool.
So I signed up for Pipe Drive, which is allowing me to manage all the incoming leads and sort of nurture them through the process. I was doing that with Asana before, actually Trello before. I was trying to do that unsuccessfully. You know, and now I'm doing it successfully along with the value-based pricing. So the way that I built the flow is, you know, so you're coming in basically what you teach. So they're coming in through Pipe Drive. And then when they leave Pipe Drive, a project is automatically created within Asana that I then execute on and make sure that I'm hitting their messaging right in the podcast
and
all that stuff. So that's the, you know, that whole flow is the takeaway for me. One other piece that I wanted to throw in there, you and I sort of dialogued about through email, I think, was I did with the $14,000 proposal, I did overshoot the mark, right? So my initial proposal, I think was $17,000 or $18,000, something like that. But they came back and they were like, yeah, we can do it, but you know, our budget is $14,000 or something like that. So what I did was, the resubmitted proposal, I didn't want to discount my rates at all and say, okay, well, I'm only going to charge you this much for an ad insertion. Kept all that stuff the same. And then I added a line item, or not a line item, but I added a line in the total for discount for prepayment.
Yeah.
So basically I gave them a $3,000 discount if they paid the entire $14,000 up front, you know, and then in my head, if they said, well, we can't pay that, I was going to say, well, okay, I'll let you do 50-50, right? Yeah. But I wasn't going to mention the 50-50 unless they pushed back on the 100%.
Right.
They didn't push back on the 100% and they've already paid. So
yeah, that's great. This is actually something I was talking about with Gareth Pronovost as well. And other people watching this, you can actually go and watch my interview with Gareth, who is another customer who purchased the program, who quit his job and has built a consulting business now. And since he purchased, we've been connecting in my private Slack channel. So if you do get the program and you can join me in Slack, this is one of the benefits of joining, because then we've been chatting, we've been swapping proposals quite a lot to compare notes. And since I made the program a while ago now, I need to do an update, really, because so much has changed. But we've been able to keep in touch, and I've been able to keep in touch with customers like you in Slack and share the things that I'm doing now, like prompt payment discounts, payment plans over, few installments over a few months. So I just wanted to say, like, it's been great connecting with you, Gareth, in the Slack channel, because I'm learning from you guys now. And so thanks for what you're teaching me as well.
No, thank you. Yeah, like I said, it has literally changed the way I'm doing business. And you know, to wrap it up into a bow, I guess the part of my head, you know, like when you talk about quitting your job and you show the sort of graph of how much it took for you to quit your job and to feel comfortable about it. Looking at it from that perspective, my number was, I think it was around, you know, if I could pull in $6,000 or $10,000 a month, then I would feel comfortable. But I'd want to be able to do that sustained, not like 6,000 one month, 4,000 the next month. You know, I want to be able to do that constrained or consistently rather. But using these techniques and using just sort of the value-based pricing and locking everything into sort of the nice pipe drive Asana flow, where I know where everything is going and I can see how much is coming in and, you know, all that stuff, I'm on target, I believe, knock on wood, I'm on target to hopefully hit around $30,000 for this, you know, this sort of, not the quarter, maybe a two-month period. So that's not bad if you look at it over the year. And that is just from the advertising on the podcast. It's not including any digital product sales or outside consulting or anything like that. So yeah, I'm really excited about it.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I it's very rewarding for me to hear of people that have had the trust really to say, yeah, I'll buy your program and give it a go. And then to hear the stories coming back, like, wow, like it's had such an impact on me. So it's just great feedback for me to hear. So thank you. I'm so glad that it's working well. And Gareth was the same. He said, I think he's consistently doing about 15, 20K. He's at a 25K month now. And it's amazing. Like it's hard to imagine going back to a real job after you have a few months like that.
Yeah, I've thought about it. I mean, because, you know, we've all thought about it. It's like, well, you know what, it'd be... Because my pedigree is I used to work at Apple and Google and Adobe, you know, and then I left. That's a whole nother story. And I left that to do this kind of stuff. And occasionally I'll have the pangs of, wow, sure would be nice to have just that regular paycheck. I know exactly to the penny how much it's going to be and when it's going to show up every single, you know, every 2 weeks. And then I think about the negatives of that. And the negatives were, I mean, you know the negatives, right? It's just working for someone else, no control over your future, and, you know, it being sort of limited on how much you can make. And it just went on and on. So doing this, this is much better. And it's it gets much better when you are in a period where you have a sustained baseline of income coming in. Because it's scary when you're like, wow, I have no money in the bank. And I got to try to make it to next week, and that client is not calling me back. So what should I do, right?
Yeah, but it is funny.
When you're beyond that, and you have a cushion, and you know that money's coming in, and I'm using these sort of tried and true systems like you teach, then it becomes easier to see. I can look on my computer right now and see that, hey, I should probably call these three people today to make sure that I'm moving them along, and my deal flow is healthy versus
That's where pipe drive is so useful. Now, I can definitely relate to all that. I've talked about it on my podcast before. For the whole first year of full-time work, even though I was doing really well, I was like, oh my God, this is just going to come to an end. My work's going to dry up. So the anxiety is something that can take a while to get comfortable with, but I think, definitely the pros outweigh the cons.
Yeah. The other thing I'll just throw in there real quick is that, it all sounds like gravy. Like, yeah, I want to do that and live my own life and be in control of my own destiny. But the negative side of that is you are the single point of failure. Yeah. So if you get sick, if you get tired, you get a flu or something, especially me, because I'm a podcaster and I am the face and the voice of the show. If I go away, the machine grinds to a halt. So I'm in the process of sort of shoring that up by making some other processes, some income stream that don't rely on me, so that the boat can keep floating if I go away or if I have to take a hiatus for some reason. I need the machine to keep generating revenue so that everything continues to work. So
yeah, and this is something with consulting or freelancing, podcast, whatever you do, if you have this income, your primary source of income coming from somewhere, once you're comfortable, once you're established, like, you can actually use that additional income and time and flexibility that you have now to then focus on other things. So I've got my whole product side of my business. I do affiliate marketing. I've got some sponsorship that I do as well. So it's nice that you can, the bulk of my income does come from consulting, but that has allowed me to actually work more. And now that I've quit my job, actually it was a while ago now, but I can spend more time on these other things and diversify and have a few other revenue streams. And consulting has allowed me to do that.
I love it.
Well, I could keep talking, and definitely I think a call for another day to learn more about your processes and how you're systemizing things. But no, thank you for just sharing your story. If people want to get in touch with you or learn more about you, what's the best way to do that?
Just head over to thisweekinphoto.com. That's my Rome. All roads lead to thisweekinphoto.com.
Great. Well, Frederick, one more time, thank you so much for jumping on the call and sharing your story.
You're welcome, Paul. Thank you. And thank you for everything. I appreciate you.